Slide victory. Let's talk a little about that. And, you know, for those who may not be familiar with the terminology, Roy Slide, what happened back in 1988 and that prolific photograph?
In 1988, right. 1988 in Bodden Town. That was actually the third election I was contesting. I first began in 1980 and then again in 1984. And I noticed that I made a significant advance in the number of votes I got in 1984 from when I started in 1980. And I thought, aha, if I can carry this momentum into the next 4 years, I am bound to be able to win one of the two seats. Mm-hmm. And so I worked really hard. And I had an inspirational thought. I coined a slogan, "Time has come." And that was my slogan. I carried that into the election. It's about that.
Yeah, the photo itself is iconic, right?
Yeah.
Back in 1988, the electoral system was different to what it is today. We have one man, one vote, but back then we had the electoral district system.
My constituency extended from where we call Spots Newlands. All of the distance, and I went house to house. It's easier now because you have your constituency is confined. Mm-hmm. Then it was, in a sense, much more difficult to cover. But I contend, you know, the chances of winning were significantly less than they are now. But in a way, it was more fun. Mm-hmm.
So looking at the change in the electoral system, given your assessment, the application of one man, one vote, do you see it as something that's still going through a teething process, or have the voters' reception accepted it wholeheartedly?
Many people many people are disillusioned with the one man, one vote. I never supported it. Even disagreeing with my good friends and close confidants, because I saw that to that in terms of our system. The one man, one vote in the Cayman Islands is too easy for politicians to get entrenched, because it effort in gaining a majority. You could just slide over the bar and you're a winner. The open system we had was much more challenging, much more difficult, and I thought it gave greater representation. For example, let's take Bodden Town. In the old days, Bodden Town had, it went from 3 representatives, 2 representatives, and then to 3. Well, if you live anywhere in Bodden Town, from Frank Sound to down by Spots Newlands, you had a representative. Now with the narrow confined areas, you have Bodden Town East and Bodden Town West. And if I live in Bodden Town East, and if I have a problem, and I don't see my, and I go to the person representing, but they say, I'm sorry, I'm not your representative. Your representative's in Bodden Town East. Whereas before, the 3 persons that are elected to Bodden Town were, no matter where they were Bodden Town representatives, and anyone, any part of the constituency could make a call upon them.
But you do have that kind of cross-pollination happening too, right? I mean, if someone is, say, for example, in same constituency, Bodden Town East, sometimes the Bodden Town East and Bodden Town West, the lines are blurred for some people who are still trying to get accustomed to it. So if they see either one of the MPs and they may not fall within that boundary.
But I can only go by the complaints I hear people saying. They say when they approach the people, they say, I'm sorry, you have to take it to your representative. I'm not really your representative, although I'm from the district of Bodden Town. So that's one of the downsides. People also talk about the idea it's too easy to garrison off the constituencies when they're like that. Meaning garrison is a Jamaican term, meaning that you have a stranglehold on it and you say, hey, this is my territory. You dare not come inside here. You how dare you come here? So there's a kind of exclusivity, which didn't happen before.
Mm-hmm. But can we reverse the clock then? I mean,
of course. These decisions are not irreversible. I mean, if the majority gets in, and they can reverse that. If a majority is so minded, they can reverse that. Mm-hmm. Or if enough of the public petition, they're bound to take these things into consideration.
But do you see a groundswell of support to make that change?
Well, I don't see a groundswell of support now, but I hear people complaining. So let's see what happens, because the system is just still being, the teething problems are still being worked out. But let's take another example of how much more expensive it is now in terms of governance. Now you have 19 representatives. You know, in my time it was 15, so that's 4 more. The cabinet is significantly increased now and all that kind of stuff. So was that necessary? I don't know. Does the results that we're getting, does that justify the significant increases in salary and expenses that we have? I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, back in 1988, the campaigning formula was completely different. You didn't have social media back then. You didn't have that kind of engagement happening with the voters and their representatives and prospective candidates. Do you think that this time around for the 2021 election, the real battleground is in social media versus going back into the community, or is it a disconnect in how the traditional method of campaigning has become?
Reshma, I don't even have to blink my eye to give you the answer to that question. Definitely. Social media has been a revolution, been a revolutionizing force in Caymanian politics, so much so that it has changed the political style from the linear style to a more interactive style. It has in one quantum leap educated and emboldened the electors and the voters now, so that sometimes I feel sorry for the people who set themselves up to be representatives, and especially in this case, incumbents, because according to what I read on social media, some of them are getting tarred and feathered. Mm-hmm. So social media has been a revolutionary force, and I don't use that matter lightly. It's a godsend. It has created an awareness, an educational awareness, a political literacy that we would have taken decades to achieve otherwise.
All right, interesting. All right, we're going to take a quick break and continue the conversation with Mr. Bodden. Do stick around. We'll be right back.
The tropical rhythm. Rhythm. Tropical rhythm at 20. So the vibes have a turn up and the rhythms have a plenty. Tropical rhythm.
That the coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm.
I'm Vicky Wheaton. Join me as I meet some of Cayman's most interesting people.
It's time to develop. I've been noticing it. I've been following it. I've been following the trend.
Mm-hmm. So how much of a, getting back into the community would candidates have to do, given the short space of time that we have for the election this time around, because the election has a shorter campaigning period?
Well, I will tell you this. You will see those candidates who place emphasis on going door to door. I would venture to say that those candidates will score better than those persons who rely on what I call long distance and more informal communicating styles. Because in 1988, for example, you drew reference it. Everybody came out to public meetings. That then was, in addition to being informed on the political issues, it was a kind of networking. It offered networking and a social gathering where you came to see your friends, you came to exchange ideas. Now that's not so important now, because the whole avenue has changed. There's social media, there's television, and there's the print media. So that to be successful now, you need to be in control of multifaceted forces of communication to get your message across.
Mm-hmm. Looking at the, and I'm sorry to go back to it, but even in social media, you've seen, you mentioned it, the tar and feathering of candidates, the collective attacks that you see coming out from various quarters. How much of an influence do you think a voter, and I'm talking about registered voters, because everybody has an opinion, right? Mm-hmm. But not everybody has a vote.
Right.
So how much of a real impact do you see those having when it comes to influencing who's going to form what alliance or who's going to form a coalition?
Well, in terms of the comments that are made, even the comments, and many of them are negative, if there's an element of truth in them, they're bound to influence voters. And for example, because of the whole prevalence now of social media, much about incumbency. What I noticed too, which I want to make a point on your show, mm-hmm. Reshma, is that the whole mystique that surrounded incumbency is debunked. Incumbents that wasn't so before, because it's like all of a sudden the emperor has no clothes. People and the incumbents who believe that incumbency is going to guarantee them a return are sadly mistaken. The challengers that are coming now are younger, they're more educated, they're more media savvy, they're more issue savvy, so that the incumbents who are dinosaurs are going to get a rocking. And I'd stick my neck out to say, as a political analyst, there are going to be some upsets. There are going to be some significant upsets. Some incumbents are going to lose their seats.
But the flip side to that would be, I mean, you're talking about the emperor has no clothes, but the flip side to that is you have fresh faces who are also equally going to be exposed for who they are, their background. Do you see that really unseating? We already know what we're getting versus we don't know who's coming.
I mean, that's going to change. And it might not change. Like I say, it might not be a radical change this election. You mean better the devil you know than the devil you don't know?
Yes.
Those attitudes are going to change. Mm-hmm. So a little of that may prevail now.
Yeah.
But in the next 4 years, that's going to be out. Because the candidates that are coming forward now, I've seen them. These are young, articulate, university-educated people. Mm-hmm. And people are going to say, we have to give these a chance. For example, an issue like the
We hear quite often the jobs, immigration, education, training, overpopulation. You and I had that conversation before about overpopulation, overdevelopment. Why do you see these continually reoccurring, and deservedly so reoccurring? But is it that these are not being dealt with? Why do we see these same issues popping up all the time?
Because they're not being dealt with in a way that the general public expects them to be dealt with. They see them as a threat foretold the future stability of the Caymanian society. And that's why they're concerned. And these are the issues that young people are parroting. These are the issues that young people are touting because they see them as a direct threat to their future. The ability to access jobs, the ability to access affordable housing, the ability to travel on streets which are not congested in traffic. And some of the more mature people are concerned about those issues, but it's mainly young people, and it's mainly young people whose ideas are going to influence the future wave of the way we think politically and the political direction we take. And young people are soon going to be demanding that we come up with 5-year development plans, which we should have had a long time ago, so that people can know 5 years from now, this is the level of population we expect, these are where the population centers are going to be, and so on and so forth.
Okay. Now, I want to drill down on those issues, because how effective can, say, someone who is in opposition really change these or make any significant impact on these issues if you're stuck in opposition?
Okay, so that brings us to an important point. The way forward politically. What about the party system? The party system. You know, many people seem to shy away from that. The reason they can't seem to shy away from that, and I listen again to people talk, young and old, with the exception of 1962, when the late Ormond Patton came out with the National Democratic Party, there was Team Cayman, of which I was a part in the early 90s. We had a party that was what I call a real grassroots political party with from the constituencies up to the national level. The other parties since that, including the UDP, have been built around cults of personality. So if you check it, Reshma, the politics in Cayman in the last little while have been built around, the groupings have been built around cults of personality. And as that person or personality goes, so goes the party. So there's no party structure. For example, a person appoints himself or herself the leader and pick the other people around him. It doesn't come from the rank and file membership and goes right up. So the party system as it exists in Cayman is unstable. It's kind of non-existent. People gravitate toward groupings. Well, I like this person or this person. This person will follow me. Mm-hmm. And not on any system. I call it pirate politics. Every man for himself and God for us all.
I'm glad you brought up party politics, because that was the next point that I wanted to raise. Looking at, are we a one-party system right now? Because we have the CDP, whose leader is Makiva Bush, but that party is not a factor in this election. You have three separate candidates who by association, have been members of the CDP. And then you have the Progressives that is fielding candidates as a political organization. And then you have Mr. Ezzard Miller's party, the Cayman Islands People's Party. But are we really, do we even have a party?
We don't have a party. Because even the Progressives, they're a hodgepodge. They don't have a full slate of candidates. They can't form a majority. They're going around recruiting people that they think may have similar interests. It's a whole informal organization, you know, based on one person. The person says, okay, I want to be the leader. I think I like this guy over here in East End. I'm going to talk with him. I like this person in West Bay. I'm going to talk with him. But there's no formal alliance. There's no instrument that say, this is the platform. There's no ideology. That's what differentiates a party. The party has to have an ideology. So if you have someone from East End, someone from Northside, it's just a marriage of convenience. And more often than not, it winds up as an unholy alliance. When they get in the assembly, they may go in as a group, but chances are they split off on issues. And there's that kind of flexibility which would not normally exist in a political party. So in a manner of speaking, although this is the 21st century, we are backwards still. Because when you vote for somebody, you don't know who you're voting for. Mm-hmm. You don't know that the person you're voting for is going to be in the majority or in the minority. It depends on them horse trading after the election to find out if they can get a seat. That's why some people say, I want to go with this person because they promised me a seat. Whereas if you had a slate of candidates, a party, you would know, the party would know beforehand, Reshma, who the cabinet would be. Mm-hmm. And they would say, Roy Bodden is likely to be the Minister of Tourism. Reshma is going to be the Minister of Education. So you go to the polls as an informed voter. Mm-hmm. And you say, I like this slate of candidates. And you tell your sister in West Bay, that's who I'm voting for. Because these people, we already know when we vote for this party what we're getting. But it's not so now.
Well, I mean, now we see as the campaign stretches on, we have alliances being formed. There's no bones about it. A coalition government is going to have to form the next administration to take us forward for the next 4 years.
I think you're right. And therein lies the challenge. Because you're going to get all kinds of horse trading. Well, I'll come with you, but this is what I want. Mm-hmm. So in a way, it puts the leader or the supposed leader of that organization at a disadvantage because he may have to give more than he's prepared to give in order to command a majority. And so it's a kind of awkward situation. And the loyalties are more mercenary than they are guaranteed.
Mm-hmm. When you look at the... So we have the progressives, but we also have independents, pockets of independents as well. And the horse trading that happens after going into the election now, you're seeing the alliances take shape. You're seeing people on platforms. You're seeing people come together as campaign launches happen coming in the coming days. Outright, like you said, you don't know who's going to be the tourism minister. You don't know who's going to be education, health. And can you realistically make those decisions now?
No, you can't.
Before you get into,
no, you can't.
Into that?
No, you can't. And here's another dilemma. Who is to say that the same person is talking to you, not talking to me? Mm-hmm. You see? There's no guarantee that the person that is talking to you about aligning with you is not talking to me about aligning with me. In a party, however, that possibility couldn't exist. You'd have to be fish or fowl, and you couldn't be talking to both because that's how it is. I see right now there are at least two elements that are going to be competing for a majority interest, for the majority members, and I'm sure that there are some elements who are talking to both of these potential leaders. If I were a wagering man, I would wager that.
But, I mean, think about it. You don't go into elections to lose, do you? So, like you said, without that party structure, you have that freedom of movement. You're not restrained. So is it that you're advocating that we have a more formalized party structure?
Oh, definitely.
Because
in definitely, the current,
yeah.
Definitely. I have always advocated that. I've always been a part of it. And that is better, Reshma, for the electors as well. That is better for the voting public as well, because the voting public can then be more informed. They know there is more of a certainty. If they know that they vote for Roy Bodden, they know this is what Roy Bodden stands for, and this is whom he is standing with. And so they can make a more informed decision.
Mm-hmm. Now, regionally, I mean, this dilemma that we face is not something that's unique to Cayman. I mean, regionally, you have the organized party structures, but you do have that splintered off groups that have the pockets of independence, and you do have the similar horse trading happening.
But the independents in such a system are hardly that important that they can make a difference to the parties. If you check Jamaica, for example, mm-hmm. if you check Barbados and Trinidad, few independents get in, but they don't influence the formation of the government because the established parties will have their full platforms, their full slate of candidates that they're running. And if picking up one or two independents will bolster their position, that's fine. But it's not an absolute necessity for them in order to be in a position of influence.
Mm-hmm. Well, one may argue that we're still a young democracy, feeling our way through.
But it has nothing to do with youth. It has nothing to do with youth. Mm-hmm. It has to do with political education and political literacy. And according to the constitution we have, this constitution is a constitution which is crafted for political parties. And so at the same time we have the constitution, we should have been developing that. To an extent, it's the fault of the people who put themselves forward as leaders that the populace is not educated to accept political parties as an important part of the political culture and the political landscape.
All right, we're going to take a quick break to digest all that information that Mr. Bodden has now imparted to us. So stick around, we'll be right back.
And the rhythm and the tropical rhythm. Rhythm. Tropical rhythm at 20. So the vibes have a turn up and the rhythms have a plenty. Tropical rhythm.
That the coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm.
Hi, I'm Vicky Wheaton. Join me as I meet some of Cayman's most interesting people.
And the rhythm and the tropical rhythm. Rhythm. Tropical rhythm at 20. So the vibes have a turn up and the rhythms have a plenty. Tropical rhythm.
That the coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm.
Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm. Coolest rhythm.
You know, starting a foundation and coming from very humble beginnings, because ultimately it was just an idea. My partner had come up with the fact that we'd been very involved with the breast cancer and the cause as a whole, because of Brenda's passing when she was 36. Basically, 10 years later, he decided that, you know, he had some jewelry and things like that that he wanted to go on, sell off and raise some additional funds for donating back to breast cancer. And so we wrapped an event around it and had this nice event that went on actually at the Marriott at the time. And even from, if I remember correctly, from that event, the Compass came on board at that stage and have been involved ever since then, and that's now over 10 years. I guess the charity actually has only been a full charity for about 10 years, but we had actually started with this previous event, which then what happened was it was meant to be a one-off, and from there it was such a success that we decided, hey, we can actually really do something and help. So from there we decided to do next year, and at that stage we went to the Westin. And then ended up having more of a structure to it. And at that point, after that, we decided we had to set up the foundation because we really wanted to make sure that the funds at the end of the day were going to where it really could do its best best to help people. And we thanked the Compass for their support and assistance from day one. And we look forward to a continued future together.
Thank you for staying with us here on the Resh Hour. We continue our conversation, an all-important conversation, I would say, with none other than Roy Bodden, historian, author, and of course, political analyst. I want to turn the conversation now to and go back to the stats, where we have and we have some which we, and of course, this is from the Elections Office, pertaining to the January list, because of course, the April 1st list, which will be used in the election, is still being revised and that will be produced. But the numbers are telling here, and I want to look specifically at the female stats, the largest voting bloc. The numbers paint a picture. We have the largest number of voters, according to the January list, 2,768 females between the ages of 45 to 54. And looking at that, I want to draw a correlation with the number of female candidates. Now, we had in the 2017 elections, we had 63 candidates down to 61 after the disqualification. This time around, we have 50 candidates, and we have 11 of those candidates being female. Let's talk a little about the influence of the female vote in this election and the number of female candidates we're seeing.
Well, before we get to that, Reshma, if you will allow me, I have an observation I would like to make as a historian. You know, I'm trying to come to grips with this, that it was women, Caymanian women, who played the greatest part in the democratization of politics in these islands, particularly as it relates to universal adult suffrage. It was women who in 1948 forwarded a petition to the then commissioner seeking the right to vote. It was a woman, Eric Cook Bodden, who first approached Commissioner Andrew Morris Gerard about standing as a candidate in elections. And thereafter, in the formative years, women played a prominent role. And you're right. I'm grappling, trying to find an explanation of why women who played such an important part in the development of modern Caymanian politics have not been represented commensurate with the numbers of women, mm-hmm. the number of women there are in the society, and with the efforts they made. And I can't explain the absence, and I'm trying to say, is it because we're a male chauvinist society? Is it because women don't think that politics are that important? And will it make a difference now that women have acquired education and have seen themselves on par with the men? Will more come forward and put themselves up as candidates for the legislative, for the parliament it is now? I haven't seen up to thus far. Like you, I'm disappointed with the numbers who have put themselves forward in this election.
Let's take that a step further. Let's look at the success rate of female candidates. Even with the small pool of female candidates, have they really been able to break into the now House of Parliament? We had in the last in the current administration, we had three female representatives. Taking a step back, we had two. Unless, I mean, my memory is a bit bad, so forgive me, I've had a very long day. But even so, the number of females that have been able to break through that glass ceiling to get into that chamber is also limited. Even with a small pool of candidates like that. Why is that?
Well, you know, that's one of the things I would like to find out as a historian, as an analyst, I have my theory. And my theory is this, that now that the salaries are competitive and the perks are attractive, you're going to see more women willing to give up a professional career in other areas and try for the parliament because it will be attractive to them. The hours will be convenient. So even if it's someone who says, well, I want to rear a family, they will still be able to marry the vocation, the two vocations with a family person and a professional vocation as a member of parliament. Because in the past, I thought that was the drawback. A woman thought, well, this is really too much of a sacrifice for the compensation at the end of the day. But now that's going to make a difference, I think. So we will see if the female candidates who set themselves up this election, and there are about three or four new candidates, if they're successful, that's going to be a signal and an incentive for others next election to follow.
All right. It's definitely interesting to see how politics unfolds and the changes that go as the times change as well. So I just want, we do have a special feature on tonight's program that is related to our election coverage. So I want to give you an opportunity to share your final thoughts before we wrap the conversation and go to that segment tonight, which is called Voters' Voices, where we're going into the constituencies to hear the issues that are important to them, mm-hmm. rather than looking at it from a bird's eye view, going into the constituencies. But I want to ask this as a question, just to go back to the whole social media campaign and the whole social media influence in the campaign and the female perspective too. Because more often than not, the criticism that you find yourself in as well with an open platform like that, do you think that may put off especially a woman from putting herself out there in a public sphere like politics?
I think so. I think that one of the deterrents to more female candidates not coming forward is this whole issue of campaign style and how we campaign. I think that women are not willing to subject themselves to certain kinds of uncomplimentary remarks and to mudslinging per se. So when we reach the level of sophistication that we get over that, then you will see more women willing to come out. We are reaching that point because the style, the issues, people are demanding issues now. And that kind of campaigning before social media was so prevalent was a form of entertainment, and people liked a little slander, a little scandal, made for good campaign, juicy, they thought. But now people are not paying much attention to that. They want to hear the bread and butter issues. They want to see some sophistication, and they want to see a certain standard of conduct in the campaign, which will carry forward when those persons are successful into the parliament. And that the absence of that is one of the factors which attribute to the reluctance of more females coming forward to this point. Mm-hmm.
Final point, COVID-19. How is that going to shape the discussions that we hear on the campaign platforms going forward? Because we are still in a situation where we have our borders closed, we have a pandemic that is still happening around us. Have you seen that being fleshed out on the campaign trail just yet?
You mean whether that
would
be...
The game plan going forward.
An influence?
Yes.
The way we handled it?
Mm-hmm.
It shouldn't be. The credit for the success we've had in COVID goes as much to a disciplined population as it does to any leader. Because, you know, the leader can lead and propose one thing, but if the populace aren't disciplined and aren't law-abiding and aren't prepared to abide by the protocols, it doesn't matter what the leader thinks. So what I'm saying is the success rests equally with a disciplined populace who had the sense and the gumption to see that it suited them to abide by the protocols that were put forward. Look at the United States, for example. The people weren't disciplined, they didn't follow, they weren't cooperative, and so they had a lot of problems. Look at other jurisdictions close to us. They're not prepared. It was the Caymanian people. It is, I attribute the Caymanian people. The credit must go to the Caymanian people who said, we have to abide by these protocols for our own safety and well-being. Sure, the leadership is good. They came up with the ideas, but they can't take all the credit, nor am I prepared to give them all the credit.
But not necessarily about credit I'm talking about per se, but I'm talking about plans, policies, because we will have a change of government depending on how the election goes, but the plan, the policies after. Because one of the questions that we got today when we went into the community is, what next? Are you hearing that out on the platform? What next? What is the border reopening plan going forward?
Yes.
The changes?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Well.
So how much of an influence will that be when it comes to taking the candidates forward?
That would be very influential, because people want to know. Now people are getting weary, so they want to begin to have some kind of opening up. But they also want the assurance that we want to open up, but we want to open up with the less risk, the least risk possible. So it behooves the successors, if the successors are not the incumbents, it behooves them to follow on the plan that the incumbents left.
Mm-hmm.
So that we have a sensible transition into the next phase, the next stage, into opening up.
Now, you could never have enough time when you have Roy Bodden in the interview chair, but we're running out of time. Mr. Bodden, your final thoughts as we wrap this evening's program?
My final thoughts? Well, I wouldn't be an analyst if I didn't offer some kind of thought on what the end results might be.
Mm-hmm.
So according to my calculations, we're likely to have a coalition government.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as to who will be in the majority, whether it be the progressives or whether it be some until now unknown element, remains to be seen. But we're going to have a coalition government. That coalition government is going to include some independents. We're also going to have a smattering of new young faces. And this is the beginning of these people. Every election going forward, we will have younger, more educated people coming forward, and incumbency as we knew it, with all the reverence and all the respect, is not going to carry the same currency, not going to have the same cachet as it had where people were very reverential towards it. Now I notice there's a kind of challenge. Well, you know, we have alternatives. So incumbents shouldn't rest too comfortably, which is good for democracy.
As always, thank you so much, Mr. Bodden, for joining us tonight. I want to take us now to the special segment that we have called Voters' Voices. And stick around, we'll come back after that. Our place in the parliament has begun. We at The Compass will be on the ground in the constituencies talking to you about the issues that matter. Join us as we go on the road with me, Reshma Raghunath, asking the questions and getting the answers that you need. The district of Georgetown, which consists of 5 constituencies. We'll be asking residents here, what are the issues that matter to them? Join us as we explore some of the topics that they'd like to hear from candidates.
Now, I know we were chatting earlier and you were telling me one of the problems that you have in the community is with the motorists particularly using outside your front door, mm-hmm. you know, the speeding and stuff like that, mm-hmm. and there were some speed bumps there. Has that changed?
No, they still speed, you know. Yeah. But sometimes you're wondering where they go in, you know, because they have to stop further down the road.
So what would you like to say to motorists who, you know, use your community to get out of traffic? Because I know traffic is a big thing out here.
Yes, yes. A lot of traffic, man. A lot of traffic from more busy than in town, you know? Right up in surrounding area here. Very busy sometimes. Lunch time, but you know, during school hours. Very busy. But after that, during the days, quiet.
So what are some of the areas that you'd like to see addressed? I know, like, when I was coming in, you know, the roads are kind of narrow to navigate, Is that one of the problem areas that you're seeing in the community?
Yeah, and we would like to have a nice road around here, because most time when, like, the rainfall, we have plenty patrol, and, like, the road authority might come and fill them with a few stuff and stuff, like the patrol. But after a while, the rainfall again, it's the same problem. So we always, this road, never good for, you have your car and stuff like that, dropping patrol. Even the other time I drive right out there in the rainfall, I burst one of my tire. So we need to have a nice road around here.
Some other thing, we need more work for the young people. You know, we need more young Caymanians to have work, I think. A lot of work is going on, but you hardly see much Caymanians in most of these construction sites and other business too. The next problem is that young people are studying, they get scholarship, you know, the government give them scholarship to go away to study law, you know, to do their doctorate and other, you know, different job that they study for. And when they come back, they cannot get a job. And still, they have scholarship and the money that they borrow to do, you know, to go abroad to study. They have to pay back to the bank. And they go in and still can't get the work. So why giving a scholarship to your young people if when they come back, you cannot give them work? And the truth is, there is work, but it's only certain set of people. You have to have connection to get these work. I think it's unfair. If you're a Caymanian, you know, Caymanian should be able to can get work in their country. I believe they're trying their best, but their best is not good enough.
And that was a new segment that we introduced here on the Resh Hour, and you will be hearing more from the voters as we continue our coverage for the elections as we head to April 14th. As we sign off tonight, I want to just give you a great thank you, Mr. Bodden, for sticking around with us and for sharing your analysis and your ideas with us. As always, I leave you with a final thought to carry on with your work week. Tonight it comes from Albert Einstein. Try not to become a person of success, but rather try to become a person of value. Take that with you as you carry on, Cayman. I'll see you next week. Have a great one.